I brought two guests with me this morning. Lynn Kidder is the CEO and president of the WMD Center that I will talk a bit about as we go through this today. And she was the principal investigator for this pretty comprehensive report that came out in October that we'll talk about. And Gene Meserve, I first met Gene on 9/12. She was a reporter for CNN, and she signed, many of you have seen her many times, and she said, okay, I got the Homeland Security beat, and I'm not sure there's a hyphen in there or what, but I need to learn about this. And I said, well, so do I. So we met that day for a couple hours, and we worked very closely for a number of years. I mentioned her in my book. Gene was by far the best reporter to cover Homeland Security. And one of the reasons is CNN gave her that job. That's what she did for a decade. She's left there now, out in her own business. But one of the problems with the press is that one day they'll be covering the Queen's birthday, and then the next day taxation policy, and the next day Homeland Security. So often reporters don't ask the right question. Gene was very good at asking the right questions. So I got involved in Homeland Security when I was back at National War College. And I gave the first Homeland Security lecture to RCNSC in July of 1999. It's evolved a bit since then. But I'm proud to say I haven't missed a single lecture. This is my 40th, a single lecture since then. I always put this very high on my schedule because I love the fact that I don't get to speak to many military audiences anymore since I retired, so I get to talk to the military. But also, this is the most eclectic group I ever speak with. I mean, virtually 50 states are represented here, and I get airline pilots and police officers and politicians and corporate execs and entrepreneurs. So the question and answer period is always fun, which is why they always give me a few extra minutes for that. In December of 98, I walked into the dean's office at National War College, and I said, hey, I'm thinking about creating an elective course in Homeland Security. And Dave McIntyre said, you know, that's a lot of work, Randy, to create that elective, and you got to find all the readings, and you build the syllabus and everything. So that's what you'd be doing over your Christmas vacation. And then if students don't sign up, you got to get six to make an elective here. That'd be all that work for nothing. I said, well, you know, I teach strategy here, so, and I have a strategy to get students to sign up. Because early in the semester, all the professors that have an elective go over here to the main NDU building, and in the afternoon they have these little tables set up, and you have your textbooks out there you're going to use and your syllabus, and the students come by and talk. Well, I didn't have any textbooks. There were no textbooks in Homeland Security. There really weren't any professional journal articles at that time. But I had my syllabus, and in big block letters on the front page of the syllabus, I said, no major paper required. In December of 98, I knew virtually nothing about Homeland Security, but I knew a lot about graduate students. And what I also knew is something that you've certainly learned in your military career. You really don't know a subject until you have to teach it. And so I began teaching it, and I learned a lot. Now, in the academic world, we always talk about taxonomies and building frameworks, and I'm sure some of the professors that come in here and talk to you have talked about that. And I said, well, you know, that's what we really need to get started. So we first built, see if I know how to use this. We first built this. We said we got to, so we just looked at, okay, well, what are some things, the type of weapons that people could use? And that's the old CBRNE thing. And then, well, what's the different mission elements? And, you know, well, could we deter and prevent and all of that? Response is not talking about what first responders would do, but about when we would go back and hit the bad guys. Now, one that was new up there was attribution. When we first built it, it didn't have attribution. And one of the students said, well, you know, in the Cold War, those missiles came across the North Pole, they all had return addresses. But we may not know who hits us unless they want to tell us. So that, and you'll see later on, that becomes a pretty big issue. So we used this for a couple months, and it was great, and I was real proud of it. And then one of the students came in one day and said, you know, sir, you're doing exactly what you warned us not to do. So what's that? He said, well, you're using that Cold War mindset. Because in the Cold War, for all my military service, national security took place inside the Beltway and overseas. He said, if it's Homeland Security thing, it's going to involve state and local government and the private sector. Didn't have really thought hardly at all about the private sector being involved in this. They're not involved in national security. That's what we do in government, right? Of course, if you look at 9/11, and the GE story, You know the two airplanes that hit the World Trade Center, all four engines were built by General Electric? That's not a big surprise. Not many companies make high bypass fan engines. Do you know both airplanes were owned by General Electric? They were leased to American and United. General Electric was a secondary insurer for World Trade Center Towers 1, 2, and 7. And they owned NBC, which had no advertising revenue for about a week. That was Jeff Immelt's first week as the CEO of General Electric. Ask him if the private sector is involved in Homeland Security. But he was right. This was too simple a model. I was stuck in a Cold War. That's what Homeland Security really looks like. It's the most complex national security challenge we've ever faced. Some people would argue we're not well structured for this. You go to Bangkok, I spent 4 years in the embassy there, they have a national police force, you know? One four-star can talk to every cop in the country and tell them what to do. France has a system similar. We are so complex here. Another thing to learn from this chart is, somebody ever comes up to you and says, hey, I'm a Homeland Security expert, check your wallet, okay? I've been in this field since 98, and I've never met one. I am not one. I'm a pretty serious student, but I'm not an expert, because you got to be expert in everything from insurance to public health, all of those things. Oh, one of my students from the joint staff said, you got to add this, wild card. What's wild card? This was 99. He said, well, like, it's what we talk about at the joint staff. It's something you hadn't thought about. You know, like people hijacking wide-body airplanes and flying them into buildings. In 1999, that was a wild card. Not anymore. So that's the framework we're talking about, how complex it is. And then the other debate that really came out in 99 that has focused a lot of my work came out of the Gilmore Commission, headed by Governor Jim Gilmore. It has a real long name I could never remember, but if you just search it, it's Gilmore Commission. And I think one of the best things they brought to the argument, and this argument still goes on today, should we focus, now obviously we got to do both, but where do you put your primary focus? On higher probability, lower consequence, right? Truck bomb, 93 World Trade Center, Murrah Building, 95 Oklahoma City, or lower probability, higher consequence, which we usually think of weapons of mass destruction, nuke and bio. It's just lower probability. I have focused most of my work on this bottom one, the lower probability, higher consequence. And the reason is we do a decent job on those, and those will not change the course of history unless we do something stupid and grossly overreact. These could. These are game changers. And I defined game changer. I used it once in this lecture hall, and someone said, well, what do you really mean by a game changer? I said, well, there's three things. Kill far more people than we lost on 9/11, have enormous economic consequences, not just for that city, but for the nation, and for perhaps a generation. And third is what Senator Sam Nunn refers to as a weapon of mass destruction to the U.S. Constitution. Because I guarantee you, if an improvised nuclear device goes off in Los Angeles today, and next week one goes off in Chicago, there's a lot of things about civil liberty, privacy, and even the criminal justice system will change. We were talking before we started, before I went to meet Gene on 9/12. When I got to work that morning, I had a call from Senator Kennedy's office and said, Senator Kennedy would like a two-hour tutorial on Homeland Security. Okay. So I go over there, we're sitting and talking. About a half hour into the conversation, Senator Kennedy said, should we turn CIA and NSA loose inside the United States? I tell that story because the farther we get away from 9/11, most people, particularly outside our field of national security, kind of forget how we were feeling that morning, how frightened we were for the future of our families. Pretty surprising question from Senator Kennedy, CIA and NSA loose inside the country. But that's what Senator Nunn talks about. If we get the big one, it could change a great deal. Now, there's one other level of it that I didn't cover up there, and I guess that's what you call the low probability, low consequence. About 18 months ago, I get a call from my daughter. She says, about 6 o'clock in the morning. She goes, did you feel that, Dad? I said, feel what? She goes, there was an earthquake. And I go, where are you? I'm thinking maybe she's in California. She goes, well, I'm at home. It's about 10 miles from here. And I go, this is Northern Virginia. We don't have earthquakes. And she goes, oh, no, I've already posted the damage on my Facebook page. Well, that's what a 3.2 looks like. A 3.2, but we're not going to focus on those level of attacks today. Now, the guy that introduced me mentioned my book, and since I don't get any royalties off the book, I don't mind mentioning it. But the whole theme of this book, Our Own Worst Enemy, which I am proud to say is still the most used textbook at graduate programs, undergraduate programs, and community colleges in the country, because it wasn't written like a textbook. I wrote it for the just average citizen. But it's all based on what I learned at National War College about asking the right question. See, I could come here today and talk to you about Homeland Security, and I could have fancy wire dams and all this stuff about, ooh, here's the... It'd all be useless to you. I want to give you something today that might be of value 2 years from now or 3 years from now, either in your civilian job or in your military position. Asking the right questions. That's what we try to teach at National War College when we talk about national security. It's so important. And we have a problem that too many people ask the wrong questions in this town. Now, as we approach the 10th anniversary of 9/11, Jean was still at CNN then, and she asked me a good question. Oh, it was a very fair question. I thought it was a question that a lot of Americans wanted to know the answer to. Are we safer today than we were 10 years ago? Spent a lot of money, made a lot of changes. So, unfortunately, the nature of TV is yes, and then maybe you get one sentence. I thought we could peel that onion just a little bit farther this morning in the time we have, and then try to take this theme through. This is from the perspective of the terrorist, how I saw it, our security, in the summer of 2001. Now, from the perspective of the terrorist, and to have a successful attack, they got to get all ones lined up on that lock. And you can see, it wouldn't be real difficult. Some of those areas, it's all ones. It's like the weapons they carried on the airplanes that day were legal. The fact that we taught airline crews to cooperate with hijackers. Mainly it's just going to be an inconvenience. Wasn't too tough to get through security. We sure weren't prepared to respond. So in that summer of 2001, it wasn't too tough. We were very vulnerable. And that's what happened about 9 a.m. on 9/11. And it wasn't that difficult to do. Look at the return on investment they got for about $400,000 is what CIA thinks they spent on that attack. Think how much money we've spent since then. You talk about an asymmetric weapon. So a decade later, where are we? This is where I think we are. Are we still vulnerable for attack? Yeah, but we've made it a lot more difficult for them. It's a lot harder to get all ones lined up on there. Still possible. Now we're going to use this model as I talk today about where we should spend money. We've made it more difficult, but have we spent that money correctly? Have we focused on the right areas? Some of the things I'll talk about, you'll see that in Randy Larson's opinion and the WMD Commission and the WMD Center, maybe we haven't spent it in the right areas. One of the first questions I get usually goes to, especially when we're talking about WMD, is nuclear weapons. And back in about 2003 and 4, Congress started saying, what do we have to do to prevent Al-Qaeda or any other terrorist organization from smuggling nuclear weapons into the U.S.? That's a pretty good question. Nobody wants nuclear weapons in here. But it's absolutely the wrong question. Because when Congress asked that question, they said, well, we're going to put scanners in our seaports to scan every cargo container that comes in. And let me tell you how ridiculous this whole thing got. In summer 2005, I go up to the House Rayburn office building to testify as a witness. As I'm walking in the building, there's a radiological detector by the front door. Now, the nice thing about not being in government, when you're in government, you got to go be very nice to the chairman and the committee because they can play with your authorizations or appropriations. When you're just an old citizen, you can just... If I had to ask the chairman a question, I said, Mr. Chairman, can you tell me why you're spending my tax dollars putting a radiological detector at the front door of this building? You don't understand that when the nuke gets that close, it's probably too late to detect it? I That's how they spent your tax dollars, made them feel more secure. If you go talk to Beth Ann Rooney, who is the chief of security at the Port Authority of New York and New Jersey, she'll tell you how crazy this is. Now, okay, at this end of my port, got all these shipping containers coming in. This is one of the busiest ports in the country, and they want me to scan radiologically every shipping container that comes in. But at this end of the port over here, every year 600,000 cars come off roll-on, roll-off ships and drive right out, and no one's talked about scanning them. Yeah, a couple data points here for you. You know, we think if a terrorist is going to make a nuke, they're going to use highly enriched uranium. It's much easier than a plutonium device. Plutonium is the one you got to build that conventional bomb around it and squeeze it down. That's what we tested at Trinity out there in New Mexico back in 45 to make sure it would act, that the engineering would work. We're pretty sure about the physics. Very difficult engineering challenge. We only had enough highly enriched uranium to build one bomb. So we're going to test that? The physicist said, we don't have to. We guarantee you. You just take two subcritical masses, slam them together at about 5,000 foot a second, you will get a fissionable event. And so the only HEU bomb we had, we tested at 1,800 feet over Hiroshima, and it worked exactly as advertised. How much does it take? It looks like my dad carrying a battery out to his 55 Chevy. That's actually how much nuclear material it takes. That's what created that first nuclear explosion at Trinity. He's not even leaning too hard with that. I'm not supposed to say in an unclassified presentation how much highly enriched uranium it takes, but I'll tell you, it'll fit in a one-gallon milk jug. And last week at the Aspen Institute, an event that Jean moderated, she had General Jones, former National Security Advisor, and John McLaughlin, former deputy at CIA, and Janet Napolitano, Secretary of Homeland Security. They all talked about the fact there's a couple hundred tons in the former Soviet Union. It's not well accounted for. We don't know where it is. So you see, the right question, we can all agree, we don't want a mushroom cloud over an American city. We can all agree that'll change the course of history. But the right question is, how do we prevent Al-Qaeda or any other non-state actor from becoming a nuclear power? Completely different than how do we prevent them from smuggling it into the country? Because by the way, if that were highly enriched uranium in there, and you just put aluminum foil around it, the detectors in our seaports wouldn't see it. It doesn't even take lead. HEU is an incredibly low emitter of radiation. I had a subcommittee chairman say, well, you know, Colonel, technology increases or it doubles every 18 months, so I know we'll have a detector pretty soon. I'm going, yeah, that applies to integrated circuits in computers, and that's Moore's law's been pretty accurate. Physics doesn't change. Highly enriched uranium is an extremely low emitter, and you can shield it with aluminum foil. So the correct question is, how do we prevent them from becoming a nuclear power? The answer is simple. I'm not saying it's easy, but it's simple. Locate, lock down, and eliminate loose nuclear material. Terrorists can't make it. They can only buy it or steal it. Sam Nunn, Ted Turner, run the Nuclear Threat Initiative here, one of the best not-for-profits in town, making the world safer from nuclear weapons. They like to say, we would just like to see that nuclear material in Russia guarded as well as the artwork in the Kremlin. Or maybe the same standard that we guard our gold in Fort Knox. But it's not today. That's where we should focus our efforts. If we actually made a breakthrough in technology, so somebody came up with a better technology to detect highly enriched uranium, I'd say let's send it to Russia so they can put it around some of their storage facilities. Because the number of events where we've caught stuff at borders in the last 3 or 4 years is pretty frightening. We know stuff is moving around. And it's not that tough. This much highly enriched uranium, this much highly enriched uranium, a chemical explosion that slams it together. You know, the Hiroshima bomb was just built inside a Navy gun barrel. They just needed something to hold it so they could slam it together. So, right question, how do we locate, lock down, eliminate that loose nuclear material? So now let's go back to our graphic here. You see, there's not much we can do once a weapon goes off. Now, there's actually a few things that most military people should be aware of. A study was done by Lawrence Livermore Laboratory. They said if we just shelter in place, they estimate 10-kiloton nuke goes off in Manhattan, we could lose up to 500,000 lives. If people just sheltered in place, we could get that number down to 200,000. Now, that's still a game changer. But they should have taught you this way back in your basic training. It's where I learned it. The rule of sevens, 90% of the radiation will be gone in 7 hours. Take that times seven, about 2 days, 99% is gone. Take that times seven, 2 weeks, 99.9% is gone. That's why back in the Cold War, fallout shelters were for 2 weeks, which was kind of goofy, because if we had 10,000 thermonuclear weapons going off in the United States, it wouldn't make any difference. But for a terrorist nuke, one event, that's a big deal. 7 hours. You just go down in the basement of a high-rise building for 7 hours, 90% of the radiation is going to be gone. And do you think you're actually going to go anywhere shortly after one anyway? Streets are going to be filled with glass from all the buildings. You're not going anywhere in traffic. My plan is I have a bottle of Johnny Walker Scotch in my readiness kit. I'm going to go down to the basement, and I'm going to drink the bottle of Johnny Walker fast. And when I wake up, it'll be safe to start thinking about walking home, because I'm still not going to be able to drive home. I just tell you that so you'll remember it. But no matter what, even with my Johnny Walker, and even if everybody sheltered in place, we're still going to lose 200,000. So in post-attack, it's still terrible. There's nothing we can do there. Pre-attack phase, where we can make the difference, where we should be spending our money, is over here in the pre-attack. Locating, locking down, eliminating endless nuclear. How about intelligence collection on this? The Rob Silberman report, former Democratic senator from Virginia, former Republican prosecutor, they came out with a report. Shocked me. I remember it was about 1 o'clock in the morning when I'm reading it. This sentence, it just burned in my brain. Quote, "It's obvious to this commission that intelligence collection on loose nuclear material is not a high priority for this government." Close quote. When we get to the Q&A, if anybody here can think of a higher priority for the intelligence community. Gene asked that question last week at the Aspen thing. I'll tell you later what. First, they all three stumbled around on it, and then eventually John McLaughlin gave you a good answer. So that was good. That's nuke. And like I said, it's not easy, but it's simple. Now let's talk about a far more difficult one, bioterrorism, where I've spent the last couple of years focused on this. This is a very partisan town, which I absolutely hate. The only reason I agreed to go do the WMD commission, because we had Bob Graham, good Democrat from Florida, and Jim Talent, good Republican from Missouri. You could bring up about any topic to these two guys, and they'd argue about it all night. Weapons of mass destruction, they're working very closely together, because they understand the serious threat to not only to us, but primarily to our kids and grandkids. But I live in a town where there's a lot of partisan stuff, and I go out and talk on college campuses, and people hear bioterrorism, and they go, oh, that's something Dick Cheney dreamed up to scare the American public. Well, I tell you, Vice President Cheney was concerned about bio. But so is this gentleman. I don't like wordy slides in PowerPoint, but I thought this was so important. This was from a document he signed in November 2009. Hundreds of thousands of people, untold numbers of death, trillions of dollars for each such incident. And when President Obama said political consequences, he wasn't talking about the next election. He was talking about what happens when people lose confidence in their government to protect them. This is not a partisan issue. So what would it take? Now, last week I did a 1.5 hour presentation to a bunch of senior officers on the joint staff, and part of that was talking about our former offensive program, which is shocking how few senior officers in the military today know how fully integrated bioweapons were in our offensive war plans prior to 69 when Nixon got us out. Don't have time for that today to talk about nation state programs, but let me tell you what it would take for a terrorist organization. First of all, you gotta get an agent, you gotta produce it, weaponize it, and deliver it. Well, where would I get anthrax? Well, remember during the commission, we were tracking this outbreak in Bangladesh. Actually, you don't have to go that far. Ted Turner lost almost 300 buffalo just because his bison ate in the wrong pasture. There is anthrax in the soil. You want Yersinia pestis, the bacteria that causes plague? Here's where CDC says you can find it, you know, pretty much the western half of the United States. Find dead prairie dogs out there by Lubbock, Texas. Good chance you'll find them. Several years ago, the superintendent of the Air Force Academy's daughter died of plague. She got bit by a flea. Rats above the 5,000-foot level in the Rocky Mountains tend to carry Yersinia pestis. This next slide is a terrible slide for PowerPoint, but it came out of a study. This is Dr. G.G. Quick Groenvall, was the senior scientist for biology at the WMD Commission, and she did this study. That's the 30... of the most worrisome pathogens that could be used for bioweapons. That is a recent 20-month period of where they occurred naturally in animals or humans in both around the world. That includes anthrax plague, tularemia, Venezuelan equine encephalitis, Ebola, Marburg, all the bad ones, naturally occurring. So we can't locate, lock down, eliminate these nasty pathogens. There's some members of Congress will say, well, we just got to lock this stuff down. I remember when the Attorney General of Virginia said in October of 2001 he was gonna encourage legislation that would make it illegal for any dangerous pathogen to exist in Virginia. I just wonder what grade he got in high school biology. That's Senator Obama. And Andy Weber, there with him. Andy runs the WMD program at the Pentagon. And he wanted to demonstrate to Senator Obama how much of this stuff existed in the former Soviet Union. This building just had like a simple padlock on it that a crowbar could got into. That's anthrax he's holding in there. Some people have told me I got to stop showing that. I'm going to get Andy in trouble. Technically, they should have been wearing masks and gloves and whatever, handling anthrax. But he definitely convinced the senator at that time of our concerns about how easy it is to get the pathogen. So now you got the pathogen in the petri dish. What do you do? Well, this is the easiest part. Those devices there were where the Soviets used to produce hundreds of tons of anthrax. By the way, 1 to 2 pounds would be plenty for New York City. In fact, if I were a terrorist and had 1 or 2 pounds, I'd just spread it out and hit about 10 cities. But they made tons of it. And, of course, you can buy this on the internet or you go to any microbrewery. It's just a fermentation process. Going from the petri dish to the large quantity, that's not too tough. What kept us safe, why terrorist organizations couldn't do this in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, is because of this, weaponization. Modern biological weapon, you got to get it down to 3 to 5 micron size. A human hair is about 100 micron in width. You get it down to 3 to 5 micron in size, you just release the powder in the air. You breathe it in, it goes into the alveoli sacs in your lungs and right into your bloodstream. And at that moment, you have a ticking time bomb. If it's anthrax, could be 2, 3, 4 days till you start showing symptoms. If it's smallpox, it could be 2 weeks, but it's in there. And by the way, if I released a little anthrax here today and you walked around for a couple days and still feeling good, go over to George Washington University Hospital here and they could do every test they have and they wouldn't find it until you started getting symptoms. One of the things we're trying to work on at places like DARPA is preclinical detection, meaning how we would detect it before you had symptoms, but we're not there yet. There's journals out there that look about how we do this. You see the little nebulizers people with asthma had, the little thing they got to take, perfect 3 micron size. That's available off the shelf now. Go to the website, aaar.org, American Association for Aerosol Research. You look at the tutorials they have online. It's stuff that used to be top secret up at Fort Detrick when we had our offensive program. It's commercial off the shelf. This is the big change that has made it possible for terrorist organizations to do it. Now, the day after 9/11, President Bush, I think, asked a very good question. He said, what else do I need to worry about? We only have limited resources and time. What else could these guys do to us? Imagine if you were at that meeting. The president looks at you. What can we do? What should I worry about? Chemical, cyber, bio, nuke, more airplanes, trains, buses, they're going after movie theaters. So they brought different small groups of people in to talk and to give their opinion. I was asked to come in and talk about could Al-Qaeda build a biological weapon, and if so, what would an attack look like? About 20 minutes into the presentation, Vice President Cheney asked what I thought was a great question. He said, what's a biological weapon look like? Now, this is one of the most experienced military audiences I speak to this year. How many people here have seen a biological weapon? 2. We all know what aircraft carriers look like, and smart bombs, and all that kind of stuff. I reached in my pocket, and I pulled out this test tube. And I said, well, Mr. Vice President, this is weaponized Bacillus globigii. And by the way, I just carried it into your office. I didn't even have a secret security clearance. I was retired from here, running a small think tank, hadn't even bothered getting my secret security clearance transferred, just thought I was going to be an academic type. In 1999, there was a big debate. We knew nation states could make biological weapons. We knew that Tom Clancy in Hollywood could. But could a terrorist organization? So the Defense Threat Reduction Agency, DITRA, brought in a few scientists, smart guys, but no background in making bioweapons and no access to our formerly classified program. They had them buy the equipment off labx.com. They were originally going to give them bacillus anthracis sample, anthrax, but the lawyer said, that may be against the bioweapons convention. I don't think it would have been, but... So they gave them bacillus glabigii, which is genetically nearly the same. Every nation that weaponized anthrax first weaponizes this, or a cousin to this. If you have a leak, you don't kill anybody, and then once you weaponize it, put it in a powder, you can release it to see how your detectors work. In 90 days, they produced a large quantity of this, 3 to 5 micron size, dry powder. Can you imagine what security was like at the White House 9 days after 9/11? It's pretty tight. I mean, it was went through everything, complete pat down. And the Secret Service agent went through my briefcase. In one compartment was this and an N95 mask. And he didn't even pull that out. He pulled out the mask. He said, what's this for? I said, well, you know, it's to protect you from small particles like Mayor Giuliani's wearing at Ground Zero. Oh, okay. He asked the wrong question. Because this didn't look like a weapon to him. 2 weeks later, Tara O'Toole and I walked into CIA headquarters. And she's now the Undersecretary for Science and Technology at DHS. And while she was signing in, I had it in this pocket. And there's a guy standing there, I'd never seen this at CIA, in battle dress uniform, and he had, what do you Army guys call it, a SAW, a squad automatic weapon? Man, it's a nasty looking weapon. And he's standing there with that machine gun with this nasty look on his face, and I pull it out and I look at it, and then I make sure our eyes met, and then I put it over here, and he never asked. Doesn't look like a weapon. This is what a 21st century weapon looks like. You know, and it's, we believe it's the ultimate asymmetric weapon. Cyber's close. I don't think you kill as many people with cyber. But asymmetric weapon, just a small amount of investment in the bad guys can have enormous consequences. I wish the White House photographer would have snapped this about 5 minutes later, because the look on Vice President Cheney's face was interesting when we pulled that out. And then delivery. How would we deliver it? Well, here's my old buddy, Bill Patrick. I used to bring him here when I was on the faculty. He was one of the last guys to be a senior manager of our offensive program. There was a hearing in 1999, and they said, well, Mr. Patrick, we know that you can make this stuff, but how would you deliver it? He reached into his briefcase and pulled out his rose sprayer, and he's spraying bacillus glabigii there at the House and Select Intelligence Committee. It's about that simple. Or you could use helicopters or the paint sprayer. The best protected building in America that I know of, the White House is probably better, but I haven't had the tour, but the Pentagon, WMD Commission, we got to go see and how they protected against chemical attack and biological attack. And I'm pleased with how they invested my tax dollars over there. Obviously, it's a big target. They have this system on the, they have a lot of things inside, but on the top of the building, they have this LIDAR system. It's like a laser beam that looks out to see if there's this small particle cloud. That somebody released it upwind, now it's headed towards the Pentagon. They wanted to test it one night about 15 months ago. So they got some simulant. It wasn't bacillus glabigii, but a similar simulant, right particle size. They go upwind a mile away, and they say, well, how are we going to dispense this? They went to Home Depot and bought a leaf blower for $49.95, and that's what they used. So don't let anybody tell you that they can't get the pathogens. They can't produce sufficient quantity, they can't weaponize it, and they can't dispense it. That's just not true. Now, before you get the opportunity to ask the good question, I'll steal it from you. Why hasn't it happened yet? Well, first of all, particularly the weaponization step, that technology has not been around for very long. Al-Qaeda built their laboratory, and were working on it in 1999. Rolf Moet Larsen, who for 20 years ran the WMD Center at CIA, is now at the Kennedy School at Harvard. He wrote a monograph last year that he is convinced that Al-Qaeda wanted to have an anthrax attack along with the airplane attack. Their program got behind. They didn't do it. It's not super easy, but it doesn't take Nobel Prize winners. had lunch. I gave a presentation over here 2 weeks ago. A guy came up to me afterwards and said, hey, I got to show you some pictures. He was a battalion commander at the Army's Technical Escort Unit. And he was showing, he would have his guys, he'd give them $1,000 in cash and say, go make me a laboratory that could make tularemia. Go make me a laboratory that'll make anthrax. And these guys just, nothing specialty, buy the equipment, set it up. So it's a matter of time. Yes, terrorists will, they like things that blow up, makes better news stories when you have explosions or whatever. 98% of them are thinking that way. But believe me, we're very concerned. For those, all of you have secret security clearances, ask your intel folks to get you a briefing called the Population Threat Assessment that the Department of Homeland Security does. And it talks at the secret level about the technology of doing this and how it can be done. But let me ask you a question. How come they haven't done this? When did we start flying four-engine passenger jets around the United States? First one was in 59, but by 61 and 62, it's very common. Why did it take the bad guys 4 decades to figure out what a powerful weapon that would be to take a fully fueled jet and slam it into a building? Suicide pilots was not a new concept. You know, Japanese had them, Soviets had them. Anybody here from the old Air Defense Command? Used to get a few of those folks. The Guard used to fly most of those missions. And they always used to talk about, you know, in the fighter world, the Fox 1 is when you fire the radar missile, and Fox 2s, you're closer and you fire the heat seeker, and that doesn't work. Fox 3, you fire the gun. If that doesn't work, Fox 4. When that bear bomber's headed towards New York City with nuclear weapons and none of your weapons worked, Fox 4, you'd ram them. So suicide pilots is nothing new. Why? Anybody answer that question for me? Why did it take them 4 decades to learn what a powerful weapon that would be? And by the way, Bin Laden came from the construction business. I think he really understood what a wide-body jet at 500 miles an hour, fully fueled, would do. Who's the leader of Al-Qaeda today? A physician. The same physician that started their offensive program in bioweapons in 1999. So what do we need to do? Well, the WMD Commission came up with this. It said, prevention doesn't work for this. It's just too easy to do. We have to focus on being resilient in rapid detection, medical countermeasures, the vaccines and therapeutics, better hospital surge capability. Surge capability, that's for everything. When January 20th, 2005, when George W. Bush was inaugurated for his second term, you know how many ICU beds were available in Washington, D.C. that day? 3. It was our surge capacity for the nation's capital. 3. Hospitals are primarily in the private sector. If you're the CEO of a big medical center, you don't want vacant beds. You don't want excess capacity. We in the military understand excess capacity. That's why we got those covered tennis courts at Andrews Air Force Base. We used to, every once in a while, a reporter would come and beat us up for our covered tennis courts so colonels' wives could play tennis in the snow. Yeah, you could do that, but that's not why the taxpayers built them. Because in 8 hours, we could convert it to a hospital. And when we were bringing wounded GIs back, they landed Andrews, we could transfer them there until we were able to move them somewhere else. Because we in the military understand excess capacity. Private sector, it's different. But here's what Senator Graham and Talent were here today would tell you. This is where we have to invest money. And let's look at the return on investment. Because we still say that the bio thing scares me, but it's still a lower probability. More likely going to be truck bombs or Mumbai attacks. But just think of this. If we make improvements in rapid diagnosis of disease, we make vaccines and therapeutics faster, less expensive, safer. That's good for our kids and grandkids, whether we have bioterrorism or not. We know Mother Nature's going to keep coming at us. So we think it's a good return on investment. Now, this will get me in trouble with the Marines, but I got to say it. I was testifying to Senator Harkin 2 years ago about environmental cleanup. EPA has that responsibility if there's an anthrax attack, and that's the only bio agent that's persistent. Mother Nature, if you spray Venezuelan equine encephalitis, smallpox, tularemia, 24 to 48 hours, it's gone. Mother Nature just takes care of it. Anthrax is persistent. The British tested it on a small island off the coast of off of Scotland called Gruinard, 1943. It took them 40 years to clean up that island from anthrax. That's why Ted Turner's buffalo died, because that anthrax could have been in the soil for a couple hundred years. It's the only persistent one we worry about. So if you spray half a pound in New York City, we don't know how to clean it up. EPA is responsible for doing the research. So I asked Senator Harkin, do you know how much money Congress appropriated this year for EPA to do research on cleaning this up? Half of what Congress appropriated for Marine Corps marching bands. I love Marine Corps marching bands. Go over here to 8th and I, between April and August, best show in town. According to the U.S. Marine Corps, that's $50 million a year. EPA gets $24.8 million to do the research. The economic consequences of not being able to go into a city. So part of that's getting our priorities right. This is the effort that Lynn Kidder led this past year with Senator Graham Talent. Looking at, where are we? We spent about $65 billion in the last decade on biodefense. People, are we making any progress here? Are we spending the money in the right areas? Well, here's the report card. Maybe not the kind of report card you'd like to take home to mom. Now, I thought they did a great job in their analysis, though. First of all, we have made progress here in the small scale, either contagious or non-contagious. We said, that's good. We defined small scale as like anthrax letters. You know, that caused a lot of money, about $500 million for the cleanup on that, a lot of psychological stress. 22 people got sick, five of whom died. Very small scale. Large scale. How many people see the movie Contagion? Pretty decent movie showing what a modern day would be like. And so, or drug resistant. We said those top two, look, don't focus a lot on those right now, because you could just dump endless amounts of money in there and not make a lot of progress. This is where I thought the analysis that Lynn and her staff did was great, was in the large scale in the center. That we can make progress there. If we can turn those D's into C's, that could represent saving 100,000 lives. And that's doable. And it would make our response capability for the small scale better. So I thought it was a good analysis of what they suggested should be done. And so now we'll see what Congress does. So back to our lock model. Here's where we are today for bio. Just not Randy Larson's opinion. It's exactly what your three guests said the other day. Lower probability, but very worried about it. Secretary Chertoff said this was his number one worry when he was the Secretary of Homeland Security. And it's not too difficult for them to get the ones lined up. Here's what I think, and I believe the WMD Center endorses as our national goal. We can't make much progress over here. The genie's out of the bottle. Even in the attack phase, only maybe that one dial, the early detection. We gotta make our improvements over here in the post-attack. And what we think is the primary goal, Senator Graham and Talbot here will say, we can never remove nuclear weapons from the category of weapon of mass destruction. A nuke will always be a WMD. But if we can get this, make significant improvements in our response capability, we can remove bio from the category WMD. We'll make it more like a truck bomb. Yeah, people still die. Still be the lead news story. But it won't change the course of history. And by the way, there's lots of great dual benefits that could come from it for your family. Next question I get, what's the feds going to do for us? Well, when I'm out in the Midwest or the South or whatever, well, what's FEMA going to do for me? I remember Hurricane Wilma. Hello. Remember when Hurricane Wilma hit Florida? I was sitting at home working, watching on TV, and there's this long line of people. Oh, it's hot and it's humid, and of course electricity's off. And a reporter walks up to this woman in line, and she goes, "This is terrible. This is terrible. Where is FEMA? I've been standing in line for 4 hours trying to get some water." And I'm looking at my watch. Okay, so she had 2.5 days notice that a hurricane was coming, and it just passed over 16 hours ago. Why is she out of water? And then about a week later, I talked to the deputy mayor of that community, and she said she was so frustrated when she heard about that, because a mile down the road, Walmart was open. Didn't have electricity, but they were open, and they were selling bottled water for the normal price. Folks, the federal government can't take care of you from cradle to grave. We have to have some responsibility. Now, for 3.5 years, I had a radio show here at the local public radio station, WAMU, called Homeland Security Inside and Out. And my buddy down at the Bush School, he was the outside the beltway guy. I was the inside the beltway guy. God, we got everybody. And we had Chertoff on a bunch. We had the head of TSA. But we also had mayors and lieutenant governors and county public health officers, the whole range. And of 900 interviews we did, by far my favorite guest was Sheriff Don Sal of Grimes County, Texas. A great American. So we're talking to him in the studio. We're down at the Bush School. And so he comes in. He got the biggest gun I've ever seen and sits down, got his hat on. And we're saying, well, what would you do if you had a homeland security disaster in your community? And of course, I did a little research. I know he's only got 17,000 people in this very rural community. I'm trying to think, what kind of homeland security disaster could they have? He said, well, I actually had one last year. He said, when Hurricane Rita came towards Houston, 2 million people evacuated. Nearly 600,000 came through my county, and I got 4 gas stations. Wow. Now, I'm just thinking about the law enforcement challenges of these people from Houston headed that way. Of course, most people wait till the last minute. They don't have a full tank of gas. They're starting to run out of gas. Now you're in the middle of nowhere. How did you handle the law enforcement challenges? He said, well, son, you just posse up. I'm glad it was a tape-recorded show, because I just broke me. I lost it. I never heard that term. I go, that's great. In fact, we got done. I was writing my book at the time. I called my publisher. I said, hey, I want to change the name of my book to Posse Up. I love it. They said, no, you can do a chapter, but you can't change it. I love that term. And he said, well, he had been the president of the Sheriff's Association of Texas a few years before. And so they designed this system that if they had prairie fires up in the panhandle, which they've been having a lot of in the drought these days, they'd call the Sheriff's Association in Austin, they'd send the word out, and deputies from the South could just get in their cars and drive up and help out. At not a huge cost to the taxpayer. Nothing the federal government's got to pay for. And likewise, if there's a hurricane evacuation, they'll come south. He also was good buddy with the chief of Fish and Wildlife. So that was the first phone call he made. Hey, Charlie, send me some game wardens. Next morning, 67 game wardens, fully sworn police officers, or law enforcement officers in Texas, 67 showed up in Grimes County. And he made the call to the Sheriff's Association. All these guys drove down. They didn't have a single arrest. Why? Because they had huge police presence out there on the highway. People felt like they were being taken care of. Remember when the lights went out when we were young in New York City? And it was one of the worst crime nights ever in New York City. That's back when I was a kid. I mean, the main thing I remember was the baby boom 9 months later. But the huge crime wave. When it went out in the summer of 2003, they're smart, man. They took every cop, came out in uniform on the street. Couldn't believe how little crime there was. So, but it has much to do than just law enforcement. Lynn used to run a program when she was vice president at the Business Executives for National Security, one of the best 501c3s in town here. General Chuck Boyd, the only Vietnam POW to make 4 stars, ran it after he retired from the Air Force. Going around to communities to try to help them figure out what they can do on their own. We have something called push packs. If there were an anthrax attack in your community, we'd want to get you, if we detected it quickly, and we get oral antibiotics in the mouths of you and your family, you're going to be okay. The federal government's done a good job, I'd give them an A, in stockpiling that stuff, having it here, a good system. They use the private sector, an overnight delivery company that would quickly get it to your community. But what we've seen in all the communities is your community, how are you going to get it out to the individual people in that 48-hour window? They went down, Benz went down to Atlanta. They did a test. They determined an exercise, maybe 14% of the people would have got it in time. And then they went into the local business communities and said, hey, Lockheed Martin, you know, you're really not going to be building C-130s if there's an anthrax going on here. How about if we brought you large containers of this stuff? You could give it to all your employees and they could take and they could help pass it out. And by the way, the advantage of it, all your employees and all their families and all their neighbors get the first doses. There's a real benefit for doing this. A push pack posse. There's many ways that we can use this posse concept to avoid breaking the bank, which it's pretty much already broken, folks. Don't be expecting a lot more money from Washington, D.C. Sheriff Don Sal sets the example. Another question I get when I'm out running around in the community, people ask me, well, let's just put the military in charge of that. I was really afraid after Katrina that the American public would learn the wrong lesson. You know, everything's just falling apart. It's just a disaster. And then the Coast Guard and U.S. military shows up, and immediately things start getting better. So after that, when I'd be out speaking, particularly to businessmen, they'd be saying, "Why should you put military in charge? They're really good." "Oh, yeah, they're really good." Monica Crowley was on MSNBC one time. She says, I said, "Well, you don't want to put them in charge. They got other things to do." And she said, "Well, logistics. Nobody is better in the world in logistics than the military." I said, "Wrong. Nobody's better than Walmart. Let's put Walmart in charge. Let's put Target in charge." It's just incredible how they know where everything is. And actually, DHS is doing some of that now, getting relief supplies to places. You know, Walmart, their command center, if you ever get down there, it's just incredible. It looks better than most military ones. They start tracking hurricanes when they're coming off the east coast of Africa. They're following them all the way through. And they know what people want to buy at Walmart 72 hours before landfall. They know what they want to buy at 48 hours. They know what they want to buy at 24 hours. Do you know what the number one item is at Walmart 24 hours before hurricane makes landfall? Strawberry Pop-Tarts. I guess it's the choice of non-perishable food for America. Good for morale. Not quite as good for morale as Johnny Walker, but no. So that's, and FedEx did fabulous things during that. So no, that's the best thing. But people say, well, yeah, but they still get this pushback. Now we want to put the military. I said, look, the military's great. We got great leaders. We got great people. You give us a mission, we'll do it. If you want us to harvest wheat in Kansas, we'll do it. You may not like the way we leave your fields, but we'll do it. We can do missions, right? So these guys at Pittsburgh I was talking to, they just wouldn't get off of it. So I said, do you have problems with speeders here in Pittsburgh? Oh, yeah, real problem. I said, okay, we'll take care of them. You guys are pretty busy, way too busy. I think the reserve component has been so overworked in the last decade. I know governors depend on their National Guard, but if they're in Afghanistan, they're not going to help after that earthquake. So one of my concerns. My other concern is, are our active duty forces, our Title 10 forces, properly organized, trained, and equipped? I've been talking about this since 99. Rodney King riots. Mayor calls the governor, says, boy, we need help. So they send the state police. Mayor calls the governor, we need help. Send the National Guard. And Pete Wilson calls George Herbert Walker Bush. We are overwhelmed. We need help. So President Bush signed the Insurrection Act. And at that point, Title 10 active duty military can enforce the law. So the 4th Infantry Division came down from Fort Ord. Marines came up. My favorite story from that is you got a squad of Marines just showed up. They're assigned to an L.A. police lieutenant. They're crouched down behind a row of cars. The police lieutenant says, guys, I got to talk to my boss on the other side of the street. 15 minutes before you got here, there was a sniper in that 6-story building. Cover me. He gets out and he starts running. He gets halfway across the street. The Marines stand up and take out, fully automatic, every window in the building. And the police lieutenant hits the street and says, what the hell are you doing? He said, you say cover you. That's what that means to a 19-year-old Marine. But to an L.A. police officer, cover me means, well, stand ready with your weapon and maybe shoot. So if we don't organize, train, and equip our forces properly, we shouldn't be putting them out there. Which is why in my book I say, if we have to augment local law enforcement authority, we should be using National Guard military policemen. Because many of them are policemen in their civilian jobs. They understand that different culture. I don't want 19-year-old Marines patrolling my streets, unless they've been organized, trained, and equipped for it, and I don't think we have time to do that mission. Happy to cover that in the Q&A. This is my favorite page from my favorite government document. Found this here in 1999. That's the USS Arizona slamming through the waves. And despite the claim of those air enthusiasts, battleships have never sunk a bomb. Page 181, here's the government document. Program of the Army-Navy game 8 days before Pearl Harbor. That's what we're trying to prevent, another Pearl Harbor for America, particularly when we talk about weapons of mass destruction. In June of 1941, the U.S. Navy completed a study with civilian scientists and Navy scientists. They determined conclusively that Pearl Harbor was too shallow for airdrop torpedoes. And in June of 1941, it was. Because it was in early September, the Japanese figured out if you just put a simple wooden box back there at the back of that torpedo, when it hit the water, the physics of that box separating would pull the nose up. On December 7th, 27 airdrop torpedoes hit Navy and Coast Guard ships in Pearl Harbor. A small technology, small change in technology can do it. That's what we're worried about. Will there be Mumbai-style attacks? Will there be more? I think we've made passenger flight safe. I worry some about bombs on board. I don't worry about anybody hijacking an airplane. My 87-year-old mother knows how to take a ballpoint pen and make it a lethal weapon. No one's even going to get to that locked cockpit door, and they're sure not going to get through. We have more pilots now with weapons than we do sky marshals on airplanes. But we're still vulnerable in some areas. We've made it more difficult. The question is, have we asked the right questions, and have we spent the money in the right places? Now my favorite part, the Q&A. 3 minutes left, so I got to end with my story. When I first heard this quote from Marshall McLuhan back when I was a kid, I loved it. And he said, there are no passengers on spaceship Earth, we're all crew. And I fell in love with that, and I guess it's because the Apollo space program was going on. You remember that first picture of that blue marble out there that they took a 250,000 miles away? It's the first time I ever thought about the Earth being actually a spaceship, and I was passenger, crew, whatever. Morning of 9/11, my whole attitude to that quote changed. Because when United Flight 93 taxied out that morning, the passenger manifest on board said 37 passengers and 7 crew. And about a half hour after takeoff that morning, 4 hijackers took over that airplane. And I guess technically you could have changed the manifest to say 33 passengers, 7 crew, and 4 terrorists. But when the crew and passengers started making some phone calls and realized what had happened in New York City, they realized the whole world had changed. And they did 2 things, the only 2 things I ask you to remember from what I said today, the only 2 things that may be of value a year or two from now for you. The first thing they did was they asked the right question. They didn't say, what's the FAA going to do for us? They didn't say, what's the Air Force going to do for us? Because the fact is, the most powerful Air Force in the world couldn't have done a thing for them. The second thing they did was posse up. They put together a plan, and they said, we're going to do something here. We're not just going to sit here. So the final manifest for United Flight 93 should read 40 crew members and 4 terrorists. Now, that crew of 40 weren't able to save their lives that day, but what they most likely did was save thousands of lives here in the nation's capital. And that's something we need to understand from the federal level all the way down to the local community, all the way down to your family. When's the last time you took your family to go through Red Cross and CPR training? We were doing the report card. We had the retired Army Major General, who's the chief of disaster medicine at AMA. He said if just every family went through CPR and first aid training in any kind of disaster, we could just save enormous amounts of lives. We all have a responsibility. It can't be what FEMA going to do for me. It's what can I do for my family? What can my community do for itself? What can my state do for itself? Ask the right questions and posse up. Thank you very much.